So with Omri Verracci, Sabrina Kunzweiler, Celine Mistre, Adam Morgan, Simone Muselli, and Sarah Noll. So what we did in this project is that we wrote this user's guide. This user's guide is a new paper that will explain how people can use cluster pictures for hyperelliptic curves. We'd like to thank Edgar Costa for his assistance, ICERM for hosting the workshop, and all the people that supported us. So I will first explain to you what a cluster picture is. Then I will show you some of the things that you can do with a cluster picture. Many of the things involve computations of Bernoulli things, reduction types, etc. And in the last part of my talk, I will briefly show you our implementation of cluster pictures in SageMath, and the cluster pictures that you can find already on the LMFDB. So we're going to talk about hyperelliptic curves over local fields. For us, the local field needs to have odd residue characteristic. So it doesn't work over PS2. So for example, we work over QP. So we look at an hyperelliptic curve of genus G, which is given by a short Weier transform. Y squared equals C times a polynomial, which we factored with the roots called R. And clusters will be subsets of the root, and it will be certain subsets that are of the shape a p-adic disk intersected with the set of roots. So this cluster has at least two points, so you have two distinct points, then you can look at the smallest such disk for which you can do this intersection and get this cluster, and the radius, the evaluation of this radius of this disk is called the depth of the cluster. So if we have two clusters, like one contained in the other and nothing in between them, then the bigger one is the parent of the smaller one, and the smaller one is a child of the bigger one. And the last basic notion is the relative depth. So for the relative depth, you take a cluster and then you take the depth of the cluster and you subtract the depth of its parent. And by convention, we say that the whole cluster picture is the relative depth is the absolute depth. This will be convenient later. So let's look at these examples. So we consider this curve C1. It's already factored over Q3. And then what we see is the following. So the roots, if you look modulo 3, they fall into three groups. So we have one root, which is 2 modulo 3. This is middle root, x minus 2. We have two roots, which are 1 modulo 3. It's the first two roots. And three roots are 0 mod 3. And of these three roots that are 0 mod 3, there's two of these roots that are 3 times 0 root 3. They are a little bit closer to each other than to the third root. So then you see here that they form an even smaller cluster. And these numbers that we write here, this 0, 1, 1/2, and 1, that's the relative depth of the cluster. And so one thing which is nice, which you can immediately see from this cluster picture, is that the Galois group has to fix all the clusters which have at least size 2, just because there is no combinatorial way to permute these clusters otherwise. So, okay, so let's go to the second cluster picture. So here I took an example which doesn't have rational roots. So there's a root, a square root 2, but there's also square root 2 plus 3, square root 2 minus 3, and of course there's two possible square roots. And then we'll see that these cluster, they will form two clusters of size 3, the square roots that are the same modulo 3. And now the Galois group does act non-trivially, so the Frobenius switches the two clusters. But however, there's no action of the inertia group, right? Because I only added a square root of 2 here. Okay. So now I will tell you a bit what you can do with the cluster picture. So one of the first things you can determine using the cluster picture is the reduction type of the curve. When I say reduction type, I mean the reduction type of this model that we picked. So for example, the curve has potential good reduction. If there's no cluster of size greater than one and smaller than 2g plus one. So basically what it means is that the cluster picture looks like one big cluster. It's all the roots on it and there's no other non-trivial subclusters. Another thing you can say is that the Jacobian has potential good reduction if and only if every cluster has odd cardinality. So if you go back to the example, we see that both curves don't have potential good reduction. But if we look at the Jacobian, the second one does have potential good reduction because the subclusters which are not the whole thing itself are of size one and of size three, it's all odd size. So we also have criteria for other reduction types to determine that. So we can determine whether a curve has good reduction or semi-stable reduction, whether the Jacobian of the curve has good reduction or semi-stable reduction. And we can even determine the potential toric rank of the Jacobian. So what is the potential toric rank? So if you have a Jacobian abelian variety, you know that after a base extension, it will become semi-abelian. So semi-abelian variety, that's an exact sequence. So it has an abelian part in the exact sequence, and it has a non-abelian part, the toric part. And this potential toric rank is exactly the dimension of this toric part. So if this is zero, that's exactly the case when you have potential good reduction. Okay, so the next thing, the minimal regular model. So instead of giving you all the formulas, I will demonstrate a little bit with an example. So for this, we consider the first example again. And we pick a cluster. I picked a cluster with minus two and one in this case. It's at depth one, right? So just the VLE distance at valuation one. So what can we do? So we can pick a root in here. So maybe I pick one. And what I do is I translate this equation so it becomes central around just this root one. So I do plus one and I put the factor of three here for this depth. And then I normalize here with the factor 1/9. And that factor is chosen exactly so that all these factors can become primitive again, right? So here is still a factor three that you can put in the 9 in the air is also a factor 3. So if you look at this equation, it is another equation for the same elliptic curve. Yeah, so if you take y squared equals this f. And this one gives another model for the curve. So if you look at this model, take the affine part, and we can look at the open subscheme that we have by. So what we do is we remove from the special fiber. So when P is zero, this special fiber, we remove the points corresponding to the double roots. Right? So if you do a modulo three, some of the roots might collapse. And this gives you part of an arithmetic surface. And now the idea is that you can define such schemes for any cluster. There's some other schemes you have to also take apart at infinity. Then there's some other UPS, which you basically get by looking at a slightly bigger periodic disk and doing the same model. And then we have all a bunch of schemes and we can all glue them together to get a regular model. And the good thing about this regular model is also that we exactly know which components you should blow down to get the minimal regular model. So it's a bit too complicated to display all the formulas here, but basically if you have the cluster picture, you can construct a minimal regular model and you can compute everything about it. You can compute the dual graph, you can compute the reduction map, so mapping a rational point to a point in the special fiber, all in terms of this cluster picture. Okay, so another thing you can compute, the conductor. So for this, I will introduce two new words. So a cluster is called even if it has even cardinality, and we call it über-even if all the children cluster are even. So then the statement is that if we have a semi-stable curve, so we have to assume the semi-stableness, then the conductor is equal to the number of even clusters not equal to R, which are not uber even. And maybe you have to do minus one in case that the whole cluster picture is uber even. So for example, if you look at this picture, so here you see also the depths are not relevant anymore. Then we can count the clusters. So we have three clusters of size two, we have a cluster of size four. So that's three. But the whole cluster picture, all six of them, this big cluster is uber even because it has a child of size two, it has a child of size four. So the conductor exponent will equal to three minus one, which is two. So the differentials. Oh, I see there's a question on the previous slide. So the question is, by children, do you mean descendants or only immediate children? So I mean the immediate, because every cluster, of course, I mean, you also have the singletons. They're always descendants. So it doesn't make sense to look at all the descendants. You really have to look only at the children. So the children of this big cluster are only the one of size four and the one here of size two on the left. Thanks for the question. So now for the next thing that you can compute using cluster pictures, this is about the differentials. So this is something that pops up when you want to compute the period of the Jacobian of the curve. So if you have a hyperelliptic curve, there's always this standard set of differentials that you can take that generate the module of differentials over the field K. But what happens typically is that these differentials do not give rise to generators for the differentials on the regular model. But of course we know that there's some way to correct for this. So in this case, what I wrote is that if you take the regular differentials, then there's some scalar times the standard basis and then equal. And now, for example, one theorem is that you can compute the valuation of this scalar using the following formula, which involves also the valuation of the leading coefficient of the equation and a bunch of cluster depth, relative depths and sizes. And what you can do is actually stronger than this. You can even explicitly find certain generators in terms of the standard generators and all data extracted from the cluster picture. Another thing that we can do is the discriminant and the minimal discriminant. So if we look at the model that we picked for our curve, y squared equals the polynomial, then this has a discriminant. And the valuation of this discriminant is given by the following formula. So it's the valuation of the leading coefficients times four times the genus plus two, plus the sum of the relative depth times the size minus one of all the clusters. In case the curve is semi-stable and we have enough points in the residue field, which means we have at least two g plus two points, then we can also find the valuation of the minimal discriminant using the cluster picture. So that's the discriminant that you can get from, if you look at all the models for this curve, you take the one which has the smallest, well, in terms of the valuation, the smallest discriminant. So this can also be computed, and it's also using the relative depths again. And there's this E, And here is the where the action of the Frobenius comes into play in a subtle way. So this E is almost always zero, except in the case when we have two clusters of size 2g plus 1. So this is exactly like here, like you have two clusters of the same size in the big cluster. And these two clusters are swapped by Frobenius. And the valuation of the leading coefficient in odd. That is, this has to be compensated by a 1 here, minus 1. So for example, in the second curve, the C2 example we had before, you had this cluster picture. So what we get is the valuation of the leading coefficient, this is 1 times 4 times the genus plus 2, that will give a factor of 10. Let me look at this sum here. So that will give us a 0, a 6, and a 6 for these three clusters. And there will be zeros for all the singletons, of course. So that will give us a valuation of 22. And if you look at this formula, what you can see is that this valuation of this leading coefficient is 1, but this E is also 1 in this case. So this will be 0, and these will also will be 0. Actually, it will be an empty sum. Oh, so it's just a whole picture with the relative depth of 0. Okay, so some of the other things you can do with cluster pictures are minimal regular strict normal crossings models. So it's a regular model where the special fiber has to have normal crossings, right? So only singularities of this shape. But you can compute Artama gamma numbers. Oh, yeah, so what I wrote here, so from the strict normal crossing models can only be done when there's tame reduction. Tama gamma numbers only when it's semi-stable reduction. Some other things, the decomposition of the L-adic Galois representation is 1 etal. For this, of course, L has to be not equal to P. We already saw the conductor in the semi-stable case, but you can also do it when it's not semi-stable, and you can even compute the tame part and the wild part. We can compute root numbers. This is the root number is the sign that occurs. If you look at the so this L function of the Jacobian has some actual functional equation. And there's a sign in there. It's exactly this sign. It's the root number. You can compute if there's tame reduction. And we have several criteria to determine whether or not a certain model is a minimal Weier stress model. So it's just related to this discriminant. Okay, so now for the third part of my talk, I will show you a little bit of the computational tools that that we made together with Alex Best. Code for this can be found on the GitHub of Alex. So this is a SAGE package. So how does it work? So you load our package, you define a field, and you make a hyperelliptic curve over this local field. And then you can make a cluster picture from the hyperelliptic curve. And then you can display it. You can even display it with a nice picture. So you get exactly all the relative depths. Can also be non-integers. So that's one way to make clusters. The other thing you could do is if you don't want to construct a hyperelliptic curve, you can just immediately give the roots. So here in the second example, we gave the roots 1, 2, 5, 10, 25, 50. You can conclude the cluster picture. And the third way you can construct one, it's a little bit more abstract, is using a matrix. So what does this matrix tell you? So there's 6 roots here. So for each pair of roots, you can take the difference and you can look at the valuation. So this matrix will tell you these valuations, right? So there's infinities on the diagonal, because if you take a root in itself, the difference is 0. It's valuation infinity, as we say. And for the other ones, yeah, you put integers or maybe rational numbers, and you can construct a cluster picture. Then you can ask for several basic properties of the cluster picture. For example, you can ask for the children. And so here R was this first, this is the R is the first cluster picture here. So we get as children, we get a cluster with 4 roots, cluster with 1 root, and a cluster with 1 root. So it's exactly what we see here. We have a big cluster of four and two single roots here on the left. We can also ask for all the descendants. And in this case, we chose to print them as a Unicode. So then you have exactly the same data, but a bit more compact. So here you can see all the descendants. You can ask for semi-stabilicity. So if this curve is semi-stable, for this you also need to tell over which field. So you could maybe also ask this over an extension field of K. It will give true or false. You can ask for the potential good reduction. You can ask for potential toric rank. So here's something so this is something I didn't explain, but I still want to show you because of some nice features. This is a BY tree. So another thing what you can make from a cluster picture is a so-called blue-yellow tree. And what this blue-yellow tree is basically the following. So if you look at this minimal regular model, this still has this hyperelliptic involution. So if you divide that out, you get some regular model of P1. So this is the dual graph of that. And then there's some colors and extra numbers associated to the edges and the vertices to picture a certain combinatorial data that is associated to this. So why is this interesting? Well, so for example, if you want to compute the Tawagawa numbers, the actual algorithm to compute that only uses this tree, which is less information than the cluster picture. So you can also construct a tree if you want and compute the Tawagawa number from such a tree. Another thing you can do, root numbers, for example, is also implemented. So why did I tell you about this tree? It's, for example, to illustrate this feature of our code. So here we have an example from a paper of Alexander Betz, about the computation of the Tawagawa numbers. It's not important to read everything that's here, but for example, there's an example here which had some variables A, B, and C, with an action of a Galois group switching these two edges. And then just from this picture, it computed a Tawagawa number. It says 2AB plus BC plus CA. And also this has been implemented in our code. So you can even make a cluster with using the matrix method. You can use variables A, B, and C. You can construct a cluster picture. Then you can make this blue-yellow tree. So you will get exactly this blue-yellow tree and then can compute Tawagawa number. And then you also have to specify the action of the forbiddenness, of course, which is what we did here. Okay, so now for the last part, the cluster pictures in the LMFDB. So we managed to compute all the cluster pictures in the LMFDB. For the curves of genus 2, they are already visible. For the elliptic curves, this will follow later, hopefully. Okay, so here I have an example page of a genus 2 curve in the LMFDB. So first you notice that the equation here that's given for this curve, that's not in the right shape for our theory. And so for our theory, we had that here, right? So we needed y squared equals this polynomial. So you first click on the simplify and you get the simplified equation. That's the equation that we used to construct the cluster pictures. Then you scroll down and you find this part local invariance. So then you see the bet primes, the primes bet reduction, and you see for each prime except for two, you can see a cluster picture. So here you see a small image. And then what you can do is you can even click on them. And then they will expand and you will get a little bit more information. So right now it's not a lot of information, but the first information is already there. So it's the depth, the size, but for example, also the potential toric rank, potential good reduction of the curve of the Jacobian. So for example, I picked this one because it's nice that all the potential toric ranks occur. And the potential toric rank can be computed by looking at even clusters, which are not uber even. And here you see another example of another curve. And here you can also see this clusters can be also inside each other. And then each cluster has a very catchy label here, which can be used to refer to the cluster. Well, so that concludes my demonstration and my talk. Thank you.